everybody. Welcome in to the second upload for Boneyard Gaming. And I think what I've decided to do is kind of make a series out of this. It'll probably be monthly because I'm going to highlight my push into pro rank. And yes, if you're not familiar, if you make pro rank, you have to then play four factions, combine the scores of the four faction in your MMR, so stringing together wins inside a 25-game window to get the best MMR score in a faction, and then do that with three other factions, and those combined scores are your MMR. If you do not make top 500, you get booted back out of pro rank at the end of the season, and you are back on ladder. And, you know, anybody in ladder knows that ladder kind of sucks. You know, you're grinding, you've got to string together wins, you've got to get momentum rolling, or you're just going to be stuck 50%ing back and forth on ladder in a never-ending cycle. So the problem with ladder is you're also going to see a lot of net decking, a lot of people grabbing the best decks. And in season, when there's tier 4, 3, 2, and 1 decks, that's not really too bad. You got a lot of variety and whatnot. But when you get on a season like we have right now where there's a tier 0 deck and a deck that I think is completely broken, which is Skellige, you're going to get the issue where you have to make a choice. Are you going to jump on the train because you don't want to feel like you're going to get run over it like everybody else is? Or are you going to try and do something different? And most of the player base, in my mind, will jump that on that train. And, you know, this is my fifth push into pro. My first push into pro was a NR, Northern Realms, Siege deck. My second push into pro was during another Tier 0 deck season in Hidden Cache. That was getting exploited pretty hard by the player base. I used a Monster Kiki Queen to get in, though. Actually, that was my fastest push into pro. I think that only took a day or two. And then the third and fourth time, I used a variance of a Tier 1 deck, which was Mystic Echo Harmony for Skoytel. That worked out well for me. So that was for the fourth time, three and four. And then now I finally have gotten in with a double cross Nilfgaard list. So kind of spreading out the factions a little bit here. It was my goal to just stay away from Second Wind and Skellige. So I really like this list. It's not my list, but we had some good success with it. Obviously made it to pro with it. So you got Magic Lamp. It's a half assimilate, half aristocrat ball look. So on this, you've got Ball, you've got Usurper, who in round three will proc your ball. He plays as an aristocrat, but he also works well with assimilate. So obviously Vincent, he will play as an aristocrat on your ball side. Brathens will play on your assimilate side. He's obviously a great card. You'll get a lot of proc from him if you've set up your assimilate. So Coop is a huge card here. You get, obviously, because it's an Echo, it'll replay in your deck twice. Joachim is huge here for that, and so is Roderick to help draw all your golds in the seasons. Certainly really good there. Menno will play in your Simulate side. Same with Vigo here. Both great cards. You know, Cupbearer is great because he's going to play a part of your Poison package or your Simulate package. And if you got a defender to deal with, he can purify. So certainly really, really good there. Glynis is your main engine for assimilate, but don't drop her first. There's a lot of removal in deck. And so you really want to set up either Mage Torturer, Imperial Diviner, or Ducal Guard. Try to get that package rolling first. Now, the one thing to be cautious about is in round one, because I run assimilate in round one and I run Ball in round three. We rarely bleed in round two, but sometimes we do. But basically assimilate round one, long round three with your Ball package. I find that I feel like I've got so much assimilate to set up, but your proc on the assimilate is very minimal. You got diplomacy and you've got informant. So you feel like, hey, you're spending a lot of rounds setting up Assimilate and not a lot proccing it. And you can kind of fall by behind quickly in round one if you don't set it right up. So don't be afraid to make sure you don't have too much. Mulligan some out if need be. You know, you don't want four or five Assimilate cards to set up before you've even procced it one time. But you want to get those out before you get Glynis out because, you know, you don't want to see Glynis get removed. Again, Roderick plays a part of your ball package. Certain plays with Echo to get golds out. Diplomacy is a Menno target. Same with Assassination. Again, Imperial, Diviner, and Torturer are going to be your Assimilate package as well as Ducal. Duchess is another proc. And then you finish out with Fangs or Hunter. Now, the great thing is if you get Cupbearer in round one and you want to use them as part of Assimilate, having one Fangs will then keep Cupbearer part of the Assimilate package and give you a poison option. I usually do, if the option to get one lock in round one, I'll also... So getting one of these in round one isn't bad either. As far as... Look, the gold package in this deck is solid. The bronze package could have some things switched out if need be. Obviously, like I said about, you know, Diviner or Torturer being removed would certainly be an option there. You know, since those are both fives, my first thought would be maybe you go ahead and put Thirsty Dame in. Thirsty Dame works well in your ball package. Certainly, you might want to remove Diviner if you put in ball, because when you give Torturer, give Spying, that's still a status. That still boosts Thirsty Dame. So maybe that works well with taking Diviner out and leaving Torturer in. I think you could also look at maybe Rot Tosser. Certainly give you more of a poison development as well. Play into more removal. You could certainly put another Assassination in there if you want the removal. Let's see. Like I said, Elzer's Thunder is never a bad option, though you might want to stay on the Devotion side. And then, you know, I thought about Remedy before. Maybe if you decide to play Ball 1 first and then play Assimilation second, because, you know, by the time, you know, if I'm playing Assimilate Round 1, I really don't get much chance to use that. But, like I said, minor issues in the deck. Overall, a really, really good deck. So, we'll jump to my match history here and take a look at... So, we started it right here. And like I said, we took a little while to get used to it. You can see we're kind of back and forth on it. But we caught a really, really nice groove with this. And right here, I'm starting off playing some Skellige. But as we go in, you'll see that I hit a 9-win streak on this. So that was really, really nice. This took me from mid rank 2 all the way into pro or rank 1. You can see I hit a really bad skid after that. Kind of didn't play that so well. But then we caught our groove again and stayed more consistent. And then even in our pro push here, let's see, our pro push ended here. Look at this. We finished out with 3 straight Skellige wins. And as someone who's not trying to play a Skellige, I wanted to be able to beat Skellige. And this deck is capable of doing that. You can beat Skellige with this deck. With it being a hard tier 0 matchup, certainly you've got to draw and play well, but it absolutely can be done. And like I said, this is what I used to pro push, but this is absolutely a 2500 MMR deck in pro rank. So it's not just what you're using in ladder, it works inside pro as well. And so I think, you know, with that, we're going to jump in and show you guys some highlights of some of the best games to help you understand the sequencing and how to best pilot this deck. So enjoy, and we'll catch you on the next one. Thanks. Hey, what's happening, everybody? So I'm going to kind of commentate over my Twitch footage here. Obviously, when I'm streaming on Twitch, I'm interacting with chat. I got a lot of other things going on. And I'm not necessarily talking about complete sequencing my cards all the time. So I try to be informative, but I thought I would do it even on a higher level here. We talk just completely about what I was doing, why I was sequencing, what I was doing, and hopefully give you the best understanding about how to play this deck. So look, Ma, no hands, playing the deck here. But, you know, starting out, we're against Second Wind. We're trying to set up our Simulate package here. And, you know, we got two locks, two fangs in there. And those are a little bit more than we need. So essentially here, we're going to drop a hunter here for get rid of a lock. We're going to get rid of a second fang. And we pick up a Ducal Guard. And we pick up Breath. So certainly, in my mind, really good pickups here. You know, when it comes to Simulate package, if you have, you know, Glennis, you don't want to be throwing her out right away. In fact, you want to sequence lowest to highest to kind of bait out that removal. So, you know, that's kind of where we start here. We're just going to drop a Ducal Guard and try to bait out some of his removal. But he comes out obviously with Totem, pretty big commitment. We drop our Ducal. So obviously, any Second Wind setup, you know, Stunning Blow is a really OP card, man. You know, four removal minimum, and then, you know, obviously the stack points on top of that. But that's great. That's why we threw out Ducal Guard. He used that on Ducal Guard. We'll just get our second one out. Obviously, we don't have Glennis in hand, but if we did, she'd potentially be a lot safer. So Oncrate comes out, the blacksmith. He's obviously a huge setup for warriors, but he's only a four, so we really don't need to use our high removal yet. We'll just go ahead and drop a lock here. Go ahead and take care of that and play, keeping in line with our control. He still got TA in hand. So he brings out his second blacksmith. And he TAs it. So now it's tall enough for us to remove it. And that's exactly what we're going to do. And once we hit it here, he kind of knows. Ping. I TA'd it. It's high. We got a big point swing coming in, and so you're going to see him just go ahead and get out. That's cool, because we'll just drop our Cupbearer in and take round one. And getting round one control against Skellige, obviously, you know, we had red coin. That was nice, but that put us in good position here. So when it comes to round two, usually we don't bleed, but certainly this was an opportunity to decide if we did want to bleed. But we just don't quite get the draws for it, you know. We're still searching for a lot of golds. Obviously, you know, still keeping our Simulate live. So getting Vigo was a good choice. Right now, the hand looks pretty good. You can see, though, I'm still chasing a lot more. I have a lot more in my hand or in my deck that I need to grab. So, you know, at this point, I feel like I'm forced to make one more mulligan. And to get a fang just really hurt. So right there, that pretty much squashes my thoughts of wanting to push and bleed for round two. So we're going to go ahead and take our time to think about it here, but eventually I'm going to pass, make him burn a card, and secure that that final say and even cards. Like I said, a lot left in the deck there for us. So we go ahead and finally took all the time in the world to think about that one, but decided to ultimately do the right decision and pass here. So there he goes on crate. At that point, I don't think his second wind is set up all that well. So that was good for us. He got out of round one pretty fast. Obviously, drive past in round two, so he doesn't really have much. And second wind can only grab a unit, so it can't get totem. So, you know, here we're at. We're in a position where we got a lot left to get. Getting Coop is great, but really, he doesn't have that much to pair with. So we need Ball, and we need Joaquim. You know, we need a lot of stuff yet. And really, the difference between an okay hand and a good hand. We don't need the fangs. We don't need an informant. We go ahead and drop that out and catch Ball. Drop that out and catch Joaquim. Skill, baby. Got what we needed, though. So that's a... Honestly, at that point, what's left in our hand is fine. This is a solid hand. We're looking pretty. So he drops a Raider who's a veteran. He's a 6. He's got 2 damage. He's going to play for 8. And this is a perfect chance. We're looking at, do we lock him at this point? But really, that's not the best play. You know, a 6 by itself really deserves an assassinate. And so, you know, you're going to go ahead and see us call Menno into that assassinate. And really get max value out of our opening play, in my mind. So really, and you know, like I said, it's so easier here to start off with Dissimilate, but really getting Menno out in my mind was the better play, even though that kind of broke traditional sequencing, you know, but that's what you gotta be keeping thinking of, hey, don't always follow the trend, sometimes maybe break that trend and go catch that better card. That was a good assassinate. He brings out Harold. You know, a lot of times you could think Harold's a quick Roderick. We do not throw Roderick out. And you know, another time is, how long do you hold on to Ball? A lot of times you'll see people want to get Ball out so you can get the status proc for your vampire. But I don't want to show him that I'm Ball. I don't want to show him that I have that removal yet. So, you know, right now, beating Greatsword is our win condition. So certainly, hanging on to that in my mind is by far the better play. But, you know, I think, you know, right now, we go ahead and set up our Assimilate by getting Vigo out. And then securing that lock, taking care of the warrior raider. So that's, like I said, pretty good control, answering his cards. So the Drummond Berserker here is like the best target for your informants and your assimilate. I actually wish I hadn't played the Mage Torturer here. And you're going to see that I actually lose a little bit of value here because, you know, that Berserker has two phases. So because he's a three when we're grabbing him with Baratheons, we won't have him in time to get him with the informant. That, I mean, that's obviously he plays and resets there for us, so we get full value out of him. Like I said, sitting pretty, we've got a very solid hand. That informant is still going to get us good value. We've got a good assimilate package still on the board. We've got some big cards. So obviously that baits out some removal there, which was a good call by him. And we're still behind, obviously, like I said, getting the Abomination before on its second phase was not ideal. We could probably grab the Raider instead. I'm not sure if it would have played for six on our side, though. So, obviously, he gets an Invader. So, you know, when it comes to our leader, obviously, playing a card from your opponent's hand, you know, everybody wonders when you should play it. Last threes, typically when I like to play it, you know, four or five cards is still probably okay too. There's a couple times where I've gotten really bad value from leadering with the final three cards. So maybe waiting to five. But the great thing about with three cards is you can completely see how they're going to sequence their final plays. So, obviously, now that we've got a solid assimilate package, this is why Usurper is such a good card. You know, he plays well into the assimilate package. Certainly nice. So we drop him out, get some proc, pull those boys back, and pull ahead. So obviously he brings out Blood Eagle. And here's where Greatsword, welcome to the battlefield. He puts it down. We certainly identified our win con is dealing with that Greatsword. But like I said, our tall removal, our final four is stacking really well. So we play leader here. Like I said, this is a chance for us to pick a card and see how the last three cards play. You can see doesn't have Mork Varg. That's huge since we've got Joachim. We know that there's no Mork Varg value. We do know that he's going to get bore out. But we know that we're going to handle his Greatsword. So really, this is just to solidify knowing that we are in good shape. You know, we do grab the Invader here. You could grab Harold as well. That might even been the better target. Even though it's low on points, it still does, you know, play on proc. So here comes his boar, which is going to start to give his greatsword the value there. We know it doesn't matter. But we're going to go ahead and drop our ball out, get that thirsty dame rolling. You can see his leaders, but that's from his weak round one and the fact that he had a dry pass round two. His leader's awful. There we go, drop ball and get that thirsty dame out. At that point, he's got to probably know his greatsword is toast. And like I said, with no Morkvarg to worry about, we get full value off of Joachim and our Coup de Grace. Even though we're down, we've got a big finisher. And like I said, because Joachim pulls a fang, we get a double poison in this go. And take a big point swing. So, like I said, things are looking good. We know what his last card is, and Heimdall isn't going to play for nearly enough without a great sword to complement it. But at that point, you can see he switches to back row. Get the coupe out. Take our points. Doesn't matter what we grab. And get a big finisher. So, really good solid play. Nice round one control. Obviously dry passed, but caught a very good round two or round three draw. Alright, so next game against Skellige, second wind again. That's why we're highlighting this deck. It plays pretty well. So we are on red coin again, which is certainly not bad at all. I think looking at the hand here, you know, we know with Menno we've got a Coup de Grace already. We've got Joachim, so there's our combo there. We don't have a whole lot of Assimilate setup, but we certainly have three Assimilate procs. So you can see that we do drop that. That Fangs now combos with our Cupbearer. So that actually, in my mind, works out better. I think with that, we just leave it as is and jump into our round one here. So he plays his veteran first, obviously that has Veil on it. You know, the Veil will help the villager bleed that onto the Veil so that they can bleed you for four. So we purify that to try and prevent that. So he's going to hit us with the Totem, yeah, which, like I said, tough card, certainly good. Not our favorite targets here for diplomacy, but gotta work with what we get. That's the RNG that is playing Nilfgaard. You know, you want to play control, you're gonna play RNG. So he then does get villager value here. So his point slam is pretty full in effect for him. We decided to put Cupbearer in background and get that bleeding, you know, off, which doesn't make our fangs work for us in round one. But now that, you know, he's got his raider out, and he drops the TA, you know, he's got us doubled. You know, a couple options, you know, like I said, do we put Joakim down and try to make up points ground? Do we pass? You know, I think we decide that playing, you know, diplomacy, get a little more proc, see what he does, because we do have some reach, you know, right now if we need it. But we'll just get that full assimilate proc right now. Pull a great sword on. So he brings a stunning blow in, obviously removes his own greatsword, even though we don't have... I mean, greatswords don't play super well for us. We don't have individual damage. We just, you know, we got destroy and removal, but not damage. At this point, it's kind of like, hey, do we want to chase tall removal? You know, do we want to chase pushing out tall cards and catching up? And smartly, we go for the pass. You know, I just think that you're down, you know, double points. Yeah, we could Joakim, but we don't know if he has a Morkvarg, which could set up a second win. So I just thought that, you know, passing was going to be the best option. But, you know, now we're on our heels. We don't have round control against Skellige. We did take him too deep into a round one. Like I said, we're still essentially... getting assimilate. We got Coup on its own. So, you know, Coup de Grace on its own. Not a bad hand. Obviously having balls in there, nice, but we know we're going to get bled a little bit. Obviously, since he's just baited out 7, you know, I think this is an easy fangs here just to see how serious he is about the bleed. Eventually, we get it out. It really doesn't have much of a... second win started up too well, so, you know, out comes Blood Eagle. Which then comes, you know, like I said, the Berserker, which is, again, a strong card. Hmm.
you know, I we're starting to realize we're stuck in the round. So at this point, you know, he's got our favorite target on the board. So that's why Vigo makes perfect sense. Go grab that. Get our assimilate value. Get our damage value. So certainly a good card to grab. So obviously we're happy to see Grimace come out because we really don't have any intentions of playing ball. We're certainly trying to hold on for round three without getting bled out. But see Grimace come out is actually good because we don't have much poison in our hand and we're not playing ball. And obviously I feel pretty confident that I can get out of this round without having to use ball. Yeah, we don't have any diplomacies in our hand. So going for assassinate. Now, obviously we're not gonna get removal there, but trying to get full value from Menno. Really, I think still the better play because, you know, we really are trying to manage our aristocrats at this point. We don't have too much of a assimilate package, so really, you know, it's about making sure we've got enough carryover for round three that we don't get bled too hard. We know that, I mean, if worst case comes, we can use, you know, our echo card to make sure it comes back. We've got Joachim, so you know we certainly have options. You know, using Joachim to carry yourself to from getting burned out in round two, you know, bled out in round two, and then getting your echo back for a Roderick to get full gold potential in a round three. Really, not a bad position to be in, honestly. You know, you're depending on your Roderick draw there, but yeah, so we finally just realized that he's getting high on points. We've got to make something happen, and you know, just like that, we're caught up. And I mean, like I said, that's really using Joachim in round two is by no means a bad move. Obviously, we're very lucky to have Coup de Grace in our hand with the combo. So obviously there comes Greatsword. He absolutely pulls the leader out, which again I don't know that I don't love the Grimace call there, you know, but certainly that's fine. We haven't even played ball and I'm fine as long, you know, Morkvarg's certainly the thing that we're always worried about. But we're going to drop our leader ourselves. You know, we see Harold in there. We see Boar. Harold's by far the easier of the two. But we roll with Boar. That's right. Forgot about that. I thought second hand we'd go with it. But we do choose Boar. And, you know, that's fine because we were able to, that's right, we're able to lock the Greatsword. So really, that's enough to pull ahead. It was probably pretty close on points, math-wise, but, you know, to get Boar out, to have both leaders gone, you know, yeah, Joachim's gone, but we got ball for round three. You know, that's not a bad, you know, he bled us, but I we still have great carryover value. And we are card ahead. So, and there we go. Roderick comes into our hand. That's exactly what we want to see right here. We know the chances of getting all of our golds out, which we only have two in our hands. They're both coming. So we know that we don't have to worry about being hard on our mulligans. You know, it's a good spot to feel in, to be in. That's a strong hand. Obviously, card advantages, all leaders off the board. We still have a lock for a potential second greatsword. You know, our position is in good shape. So since we have, you know, we're holding ball towards the end, and that's always know that, hey, you've got tall removal with ball. That, you know, again, same thing here. Hold it till the end. Don't let them know you got it. See what their tall removal is going to be. I mean, we can literally play ball in our final three cards. Everything pretty much pulls an aristocrat, so we can just hang on to it. So obviously, like I said, when we see Harold come out and he's pulling Raiders, you know, you got to assume that he's either got Blood Echo or he's got something else to possibly pull that second greatsword if he, you know, has it or if he doesn't. But, you know, like I said, we don't feel like we're going to have to face two full-blown greatswords. Can we just go ahead and, you know, pull Damien out to just deal with Harold? You know, obviously, with that veil on there, he's just an easy target. We don't have to deal with this prox every time now. Like I said, we go ahead and throw a Roderick out. Obviously, Glennis is the smarter play here because she's going to proc hard when we do bring Brathis out. So, you know, no big deal. But, you know, obviously, we've only got now two aristocrats left to play. Obviously, Roderick and the Coup de Grace. So, obviously, we got to get ball out. You know, it's... But at this point, you know, we'll be able to see what his last card, you know, card is before we ever have to play a removal. Like I said, having Brathens is a powerful card. Here comes his boar, which we knew was in his hand. That did have really good removal against us. You know, right now it looks like he's praying pretty wide. We're in, you know, we're a little bit behind. Only two cards to go, but, you know, we've got a full ball left to play. We lost Glennis. We pull that out. You know, we drop our poison. Certainly on the tallest card. And just like that, we caught back up. we still got a very big final say. Obviously, you know, at this point, great swords are no longer a threat to us. Obviously, he does get a 10-point play. Off the Blood Echo is a total 12-point play, but, you know, he didn't get the removal there. We're able to Roderick. We're going to pull our Baratheons and catch the nice point slam. So we'll get the removal there. At this point, really doesn't matter what we do, so we just go for the boost. And, you know, just like that, you know, we swing up to a 14-point win. So, pretty nice for us on that one. One game to go. So, here we go. Final game, man. What do you know? More Skellige, second win. You know, the one thing I'm going to quickly mention is being able to identify your opponent's decks early as possible is huge. So, obviously, having Glennis is nice. You know, got some Assimilate set up. You know, we have Cupbearer. We've got One Fang, so, you know, certainly got value there. But anytime we have three poisons, we really don't need that many. We'll certainly kick one. Kind of some issues I felt with the deck is that we had too much Assimilate set up again. But we kick another one. And then, you know, since we had a little Assimilate, we kind of wanted to manage the proc a little bit. But ended up getting a Diplomacy as well. So, kicking off the game, you know, obviously we're on blue coin this time. Certainly jumping in with the Ducal Guard. You know, I will say this. I know I flipped over the Magic Lamp, you know, Lamp Gin that time, but you really don't really need to flip that till you play card 7. So, you know, not necessarily a huge mistake there, but, you know, really waiting till card 7 is probably better. So obviously, you know, you see some cards coming down that aren't your typical SK cards in this meta right now. And I think, you know, that's a big part of, you know, being able to identify opponents' decks is huge. And I think you'll see that once we figure out what this deck is and we're able to make certain decisions on to hold on some cards, really plays huge dividends to us later on. So obviously we lose Glennis. That does suck. We're taking some damage here. Obviously it really isn't giving us any. We're actually kind of glad, you know, we didn't play a whole big Assimilate package because we didn't really get a whole lot from him off the bat on the beginning. So obviously, similar card we played in Diplomacy before. We use that to least strengthen our Ducal Guard so that he can get a chance to enjoy a little bit of proc, you know, take him a little bit further away from removal status. After the Plunderer comes out, still, that does synergize pretty well for him. Well, interesting. I mean, you know, obviously it's not a warrior, greatsword, or ship deck that you're used to seeing. So, still a little bit trying to figure out exactly what what the deck is that we're facing here. We're just trying to throw some feelers out. So, you know, we passed, and that's when he lets the armored out and realized that, okay, you know, that's when you see priests, that's when you see, you know, Draco Turtles, that's when you see a lot of things that kind of synergize and can put some big points on. And I think at that point, you know, that's when we realize that Cupbearer is going to be very valuable for his potential poison, or even his purification on a defender. So certainly there's got some value there. We're not really playing too hard into the assimilate package quite yet. We don't want to overdo it. We get rid of the Mage Torture. One of my big issues was, well, there's too much assimilate setup sometimes and not enough procking. We wanted to have a good mix. So, you know, like I said, we've been on blue coin, we've been on red coin, we've won round one, and we've lost round one. So we've kind of done a little bit of everything on this. Obviously, we had blue coin and we lost round one. So we're going to have to deal with probably getting bled to a certain extent on round two. But we really want to minimize how hard we get hit. Really, you know, get them to pass and force that round three. And have round three be about as long as we could possibly get it. Obviously, Totem comes out first. It's a big point slam. I think at this point we look at going Vigo. Yeah, I think we're still trying to get our assimilate package set up a little bit here. But yeah, we do reluctantly throw out the Vigo and hope for a good card that really plays well. And honestly, I don't think this is a great Vigo. We don't get a whole lot of love out of him. Obviously, you know, we play Informant, but that's only playing into a four. Still would, I think Informant probably would have still been the better play. Obviously, he's got a butcher. You know, you're starting to see a lot of cultists in here. Only a matter of time before you see a priest. Since we do have, you know, since he did proc a full six, now that is a max value card. You know, six is pretty good removal. We do go ahead and bait out the poison. And that's a pretty nice pass. Obviously, he wasn't playing too serious into round seven. Just trying to maybe force out a good card because he played Totem. But then didn't really commit too much, which is good for us. We're able to really not commit a whole lot either. You know, and we're on even. So, not bad. You know, he'll have final say on us. But I feel like we, you know, have a good hand going into round three draws and mulligans. Also, we get a diplomacy and a mage torture, which is playing more into the simulate package. I think we really want to focus on the ball package. So we're going to drop that. Definitely nice to be able to lock some stuff. So having lock is good. We do drop the informant and get a double lock, which again, you know, certainly good.
You know, that's the one thing about NG. You know, you love it or hate it, but it certainly, the whole strategy is just really disrupting your opponent's game plan and making them not play the way they expect to play sequencing-wise. God, it can be annoying to play against. But it's also nice when you're in the driver's seat of it. So we're gonna, pretty much I believe we're gonna throw out a diplomacy here, start off. We catch a good one. Yeah, we do. We get the Encrate Longship, boy. That's nice. That's for, you know, being mostly needing interaction to, you know, diplomacy was a nice card when there's nothing to interact with. Getting a great card to then, you know, become interactive with. So that was a really, really good one. And I, like I said, because we identified the deck as Priest and Draco Turtle, possibly, that we knew Defender was going to be a big one. And so holding on to Cupbearer and getting the Purify value out of him was the real MVP play of, I think, this match in my mind. Certainly plays big. Now, there's a lot of cards, especially when you're a deck that needs to interact with the other side of the board. Having that whole line cut off and making us use removal on it to be able to touch some of those cards and do some stuff touching, as like Lionheart would say, we need to get through Defenders to stuff touch. So obviously we see Sigvald come out. I mean, that's a pretty lock. So I don't think we waste too much time dropping a hunter down. Said pretty good so far being able to disrupt his game plan. So again, holding on to that poison. We see our first Priest come into play here. Obviously, that's nice. Because we do have some removal still. We said it's huge that we're able to interact with the card. Yeah, so dropping Menno into Assassinate is certainly going to be the best play here that we can make. So awfully seeing Circus, like I said, it's just nice that we seem so far to be able to answer anything he's putting out at us. So obviously dropping two straight locks. Disrupting game plan. You know, not necessarily point slamming, just stopping him from letting his engines do what they want to do. Oh, I forgot he had Yoanna. I remember, like, it's not a card you see very often. not a card you see very often.
So, I mean, it's, like I said, our finisher right now, our hand's pretty solid. Really, just, you know, still about making sure we get the sequencing correctly. Yeah, this is our first chance to really, you know, feel out and throw some points on the board. So we caught a Ducal Guard there. Really, not a whole lot of advantage to that, but, you know, that's the RNG of playing that. And, you know, it's nice to catch lead again. Said we're pretty confident we can get our golds out. Obviously, Artist comes on the board here. He's down to four cards. We're going to be leadering soon. We're going to be able to see what's left in that hand. So obviously, you know, like I said, we can play one more card before we have to get ball out. That's right. We decide to go ahead and start making sure that we can possibly proc our Thirsty Dame if need be. We're sitting pretty with our final say. Then we use leader. We now can confirm he has Draco Turtle. We know he's got removal. He's got Olaf, so we can get a good feel for what his final cards are. We use the decoction to take off Artis. Really, like I said, stopping his engines from being truly effective. And he does bring Artis right back. But we still got removal. But we know that Draco Turtle is going to be our real target there. So there, that comes. Now we're free to use our full ball and get full value there. So getting Brathen's out, obviously, you know, we've got some Assimilate on the board, so poison that. So we got enough of an Assimilate package still to enjoy the procs there. We do want to break up any synergization we can get. We've got a removal in place. We know two of his last three cards. We didn't see Morkvarg. You know, it's a possibility, but go ahead and get Usurper out to at least proc some more value. Finish off Draco Turtle. Getting some nice prac, pull our boys home. Pretty comfortable lead and a solid finisher, even without last say. But like I said, he doesn't, of all the cards we saw, he doesn't show that to last, so it had us a little concerned about what I thought I might see, but at this point, I feel we're still sitting pretty. What do? We go for the Roderick this time, just to take our Vincent out. Removal at this point seemed a lot better than bringing points in, because I just wasn't sure if it was Morkvarg, and I really thought, well, let's get our points by removal first. They got a sizable lead, and even if it had been, which it wasn't, so. Like I said, 13-point win to finish it out. 3 straight second wins, and in the pro rank, we made it. So, hope you enjoyed the vid. Hope this helps you play the deck.